So,
Yeah, for sure. Can I just write to the waiting room and let them know? Well, actually, should we let, we'll let them in 1 minute? Whenever you're ready, Paula.
Okay, whenever you're ready, I'm ready.
We are live now. So we... Let's admit people.
Yeah, I'm just trying to get the admit. Oh, I think, I'm co-host, what can I see? Okay. Okay, admitting all, great. Okay, so we'll get started. Great. Okay, welcome everyone. Welcome to the Power Skills 2020 5-day virtual conference. Today is already day 4 of the conference, and if you've been participating in other sessions, we hope you're feeling as excited and inspired as I am. If it's your first session, welcome. You will love this session. Please check out the rest of the calendar in our upcoming sessions until tomorrow. Tomorrow will be the last day of this amazing conference. So my name is Emily. I work as a career advisor in the McGill School of Continuing Studies Career Advising and Transition Services Office, also called CATS. I'm here today with my colleagues, Diana and Teresa. I don't know if you wanna say hey. And great. And some session rules for today. The session's going to be 2 hours long. You'll be muted and you can unmute yourself when we open up the questions, and videos can be on or off. We typically like on so that we can engage and get a feel of how everyone's doing. And actually, as everybody is tuning in, you can just write in the chat where you're coming from, because we've been meeting so many amazing people from all over the world joining us at this conference. So when we were thinking about who do we know who is really at the top of their game when it comes to strong corporate communication and corporate social responsibility, we could not think of anybody else but Paula Bernardino, our speaker today. She, for those of you who don't know Paula, she's a strategic communication management professional with more than 15 years of experience. She's currently a strategic consultant in communications and corporate social responsibility, while also guest speaking at conferences and panels on sustainability, corporate social responsibility, and strategic communications. She's also a course lecturer at McGill University in the public relations program. So Paula, I can't tell you how honored and excited we are to have you here with us today.
Well, thank you so much, Emily. I'm really glad to be here this afternoon. Thank you all to have logged in and decided to spend the next 2 hours with me. So again, before I begin, thank you, Emily. Thank you to the whole CATS team for putting this really great event together this week. It's been amazing so far. So my session will be 2 hours, and there's going to be a mix of, you know, theory, a mix of, you know, videos, but also some questions. I want to, you know, hear your thoughts, your comments. And although it's going to be, I'll be delivering it in English, je parle français aussi. Alors, if you want to put your comments en français in the chat or respond in French, I'll be glad to then respond to you. So let me share my presentation, and then we'll get started. So, okay, so as Emily was saying, I really, you know, as I was preparing this, you know, presentation, and I discussed with Emily earlier this week, I was thinking, okay, well, who am I talking to in this session? So I'm hoping that, you know, you are participating in this session if you are interested in CSR work eventually, or if you are looking for an organization to work for and, you know, working for a good corporate citizen organization is important, but you don't really know how to do it or what to look for. So I'm hoping really, you know, this presentation will help you with that, those two aspects. You know, in my case, how did I end up working in CSR, corporate social responsibility? It was really by fluke, I would say. And a lot of people in the space, it kind of had the same journey. My background, like Emily was saying, was corporate communications. And then one day after some restructuring, I was told, here, take care of the corporate social responsibility portfolio as well. I had no idea what it was. So I just started looking into it and really became very passionate about it and really started doing my own education in CSR. And a lot of people, I would say nowadays, it's also a little bit how they ended up in corporate responsibility or in sustainability. You know, either they come from an environmental, you know, background or investing background. And so I'm hoping like you'll see what I'm going to present today is really the journey of CSR and sustainability in the last, I would say, 10 years, and how today it's become such an important and, you know, a lot of interest, a lot of increased awareness when it comes to CSR. So let me start off by, of course, some definition. So this is according to Investopedia. Basically, corporate social responsibility is when an organization will put in place initiatives or strategies that will have an impact on either their economical, social, or environmental aspect. And so in a nutshell, that's what corporate social responsibility is. So really operating in ways that will, you know, benefit the society and the environment instead of just, you know, focusing on profits or, you know, bringing in some negative aspects to the society environment where you are. So corporate social responsibility is a CSR, very well-known term, but you could also hear, you know, people talk about corporate responsibility, corporate sustainability, sustainable business, corporate conscience, corporate citizenship, responsible business. All these mean the same. But then what do we mean when we talk about sustainability? So that's a little bit more, I would say, an advanced concept. And this is really when you really focus on more on the long term. You know, what actions or strategies you want to put in place that will, you know, make sure that the future of your organization is secured. So it's really thinking about the long term. But again, it's about, you know, the economy, the environment, and the society where you are operating. For example, I'll give an example there. If a factory allows waste to flow in a nearby body of water, so to avoid short-term costs, in the long term, this company is going to suffer. So that's why, like, for a sustainability aspect, this company will have to, you know, think long term. What do I need to put in place to make sure that in the long term, my company will be able to survive this problem? So that's why also when it comes to sustainability and corporate social responsibility reports, and we'll talk about reports later on, you know, an annual report, a quarterly report does not really, you know, do justice when it comes to what you're doing in CSR and sustainability, because, you know, CSR sustainability, this is long-term strategies, and you only see the results when you really focus on the long-term. You can't really see much win-wins with short-term. So, you know, that's why when it comes to, you know, your executives, the executives really have to buy in or really have to be, you know, have a mindset and really embrace sustainability and CSR in an organization to make it work. Otherwise, if they just focus on the short term and profits, they won't see, you know, the importance and how sustainability and CSR can help the company. And, you know, so I'll talk about the evolution. You know, like I would say when I started working in, you know, communications about 15 years ago, it was what we call corporate philanthropy. And, you know, majorly what you would see would be, you know, companies doing these big donations. And then this was always a photo opportunity that communications people would work with. Make sure you get your executives, make sure you get the people who are getting the money, you know, picture, take that picture, put it in your report. So about 15, 20 years ago, this is what you were seeing. And, you know, now things have changed. Like now it's a reflection. It goes deeper. You know, now companies are really thinking about, well, where am I going to make donations? So there's a link with my business mission. It's aligned with my business values. So it's no longer, well, I'm just going to give money to any organization. And, you know, the reflection goes even deeper. So if you're an organization that offers services, for example, your strategy will be around what can, you know, will be around what can my services do to help society, to help the environment. And that is going to lead you to either make partnerships or put in place some initiatives. Or if your organization produces products, then the reflection is, well, you know, what are the risks, the bad risks, the damages that my products can do to the environment, to the society? And what can I do or put in place that will reduce those risks, you know, towards society and the environment? So it's the two different ways of thinking depending on the industry that you're in. And why are we talking so much nowadays of CSR and sustainability reporting? Well, because there has been an increase in awareness when it comes to companies publishing, you know, their annual CSR reports. So this is data coming from the United States. It's coming from the Governance and Accountability Institute. So you see, from 2011, the last 10 years, a huge increase. These are the, you know, companies that are listed on the stock exchange in the United States. So in 2011, only 20% of companies were publishing CSR reports. It has gone up to 85 in 2017, 86 in 2018, and now we just got the data from 2019, 90% are putting their CSR reports out. So, you know, obviously it's either the pressure from society, customers, employees, investors. So these companies are putting in these reports, what are they doing for society and the environment? Like I said, these are American numbers. If we look at Canada, it's about half of those numbers. So if last year, 2019, 90% of companies in the States were putting out reports, it's about 45% in Canada. So overall, I would say Europe is really leading when it comes to reporting and CSR and sustainability initiatives. You know, the US is following, and in Canada we're following, but we're still very behind when it comes to CSR and sustainability. But like anything else, with this increase in reporting, there's also skepticism. Skepticism, especially from investors. So investors look, instead of CSR, the investors' language acronym that they look at is ESG. ESG means environment, social, governance. Again, it goes back to everything that I've been saying. It's always about society. It's always about the environment. And this was an interesting article that I read where they were saying, well, you're putting out these reports, but really, what does it mean? Like, what does it mean in your report? What are you choosing to put in your report? So, you know, the investors are actually questioning the companies because they want to make sure that whatever is out there is, you know, really authentic and really real. So I'm going to show you now an example. It's when this came out in 2015, it was seen as creative. It was seen as bold. So I'll show you, this was a CSR report from Heineken, the beer company. And it was different. So I'll show you the video that they did. And then you tell me what you think.
Can I be frank? Because Frank says, dirt is beautiful paradox. He says it's something that has no place in our lives but under our shoes. He says it's also the incubator that unlocks life's basic necessities. As long as we follow the rules, dirt lets us access food, extract tools, and reap our barley and hops. So yes, he said, from dirt we get beer. Now, if you listen carefully, you can hear the hand of almost 10,000 farmers who try to stay as close to nature as they can. You can hear over 120,000 African smallholder farmers harvest local ingredients for local production. Meanwhile, you hear the sound of company growth going hand in hand with reduced water consumption. Not to mention carbon dioxide output reduction by using something like windmills or solar panels to power breweries. Frank says, can I be frank? Because it's tough. He's aware we're taking big steps here towards the improvement of this beautiful sphere we call home, but many small steps add up to light years, so he upgrades the range of low alcohol beer and chills them in coolers that use less than half of the juice of coolers they had in 2010. Frank will tell you that it's his job to responsibly sell you the best beers in the world. Frank understands that selling 9 people one beer beats selling 9 beers to each, because they all get to go home feeling appreciative. Frank makes smart moves. Frank takes the byproducts of beer and sells it to farmers, because it turns out to be super nutritious for cattle. So now, instead of paying for the disposal of the byproducts, he makes a modest profit on what colleagues consider waste. On top of that, the farmers save money on food for livestock. Frank told me all this while he was pouring me one. It was as though his words had turned liquid and his story was now filling the glass he was handing me. I looked at the golden fluid behind the star and, for the first time, became aware of its transparency. He cares. But don't take my word for it. You can read it yourself. Let's get free.
Okay, so that was the introduction to Heineken's sustainability report in 2015. So creative, got people's attention. But obviously, yeah, like he says at the end, you need to go and read the report to really see like all the details. But you know, it was creative and it caught you know people's attention, especially you know, their consumers for sure. So again, like I was saying, skepticism when companies put all these kind of reports and these messages. So you know, we have to think about, well, are these responsible communications or what we call the washing? So there's a lot of different aspects with the word washing. Greenwashing. Greenwashing is, you know, a company will put out some, you know, statement regarding some environmental initiative or action or result, but they're not telling the full story, or there's, you know, something missing. Blue washing. There's many terms. Rainbow washing. Rainbow washing, we started hearing about this, I'd say in the last 3-4 years, when a lot of companies started to, you know, promote themselves as, you know, open to diversity, especially in June for Pride Month. You know, we saw a lot of companies, they do this in June, they change their logo to the rainbow. But then when you dig a little bit deeper, you realize internally, well, really? Are you really that diverse and inclusive with your LGBT and gay population that work for you? Feminism washing is a term that I discovered last year, 2019. And this is companies that would, you know, promote initiatives that they do for women. This was especially the case of Coca-Cola. They have a program for women in Africa. But then, you know, investors and people were questioning, well, in your head office, you don't have that many women in top senior positions. So, you know, what's going on there? Are you just using that program that you have in Africa to show that you are gender equal, but then you're not walking the talk when it comes to your head office? Corona washing, of course, came up here, and then we'll look more into details later this in the presentation and examples. So this was an article in France that came up that said, well, you know, all these companies now are, you know, talking about their actions they're doing, but are they really doing it genuinely, authentically, or is just to make them look good during the pandemic? Woke washing is, you know, when you're using, you know, your brand to follow, you know, some trend, especially justice trends in the media. And we saw this this summer. So this was, again, related to rainbow washing, this article, but we could also, you know, look at woke washing with what's going on in the States with Black Lives Matters. We saw a lot of companies put out statements about, you know, Black lives matter to us, and, you know, our Black employees are important, our Black customers are important. You know, if I looked a little bit deeper into the company's actions and initiatives, would this really be true? Or are they just putting this statement out there to be part of the trend? So basically what washing is, and you can put any other word before the word washing, is, you know, any company that would put out some content, but it's empty content. There's no meaning. There's no alignment with, you know, their organization. There's no alignment with the mission. You know, it really is, seems obvious that they're just following a trend. You know, or if there's missing information, missing context. So if you're only, you know, companies only focusing on the positive side, like I was saying, the feminism washing. So you're only focusing on actions in one part of the world, but you're missing and you're not giving the context of what's going on around you. Or simply if you're lying, that could be also seen as washing. And I love this because this came out in April, social washing. And again, this was investors telling company, watch it, be careful what you're doing. Again, this is related to Corona because, you know, they were seeing all these companies putting out all these, you know, stories out there. Oh, we're producing masks. Oh, we're producing, you know, PPP for the, you know, health care workers.
20 minutes almost. Your Tavit button is on?
And so far, like I was saying, investors look at ESG, environment, social, governance. They have measures when it comes to environment. They know what to look for and how to, like, what grade to give companies when it comes to environment. Governance, they know, you know, how to measure it. So far, social was a little bit harder. So far, social was more, you know, what the companies are doing, you know, in their communities. But this coronavirus pandemic really got them now to the investors to actually put some measures when it comes to social. And it's very interesting because I highlighted there that sentence that, you know, climate change has been top priority so far for ESG funds. And, you know, investors have been looking at what companies are doing for the environment. But now with the pandemic, it's making investors put emphasis on the S when it comes to employees. So what they're telling the companies is when you do your report at the end of 2020, and you are talking about your S, your social, tell us what you did for your employees during the pandemic. You know, how did you treat your employees? How did you handle layoffs? Why were there layoffs? You know, how did you handle mental health for your employees? And also the return to the office or work from home, how did you handle that? So it's very interesting how, you know, this pandemic could actually help companies thrive if they can take the S, the social, you know, well and seriously. So this will be interesting, I'd say next year, to see how that goes and which companies will come out as, you know, the best ones when it came to social and handling the pandemic. And then all this also got a lot of attention, I would say last year. So in the States, there's something called the Business Roundtable, and it's the most powerful CEOs. They're part of this organization. And they all, I would say, surprised the business world last year in August when they came up and they said, we've had this reflection. And, you know, so far, and this comes back from the, you know, the 70s economic theory that a company's purpose should be to make shareholders richer. It's to focus on profits so the shareholders get more money. So last year they all got together and they decided, well, no, we need to rethink the purpose of companies. Companies' purpose should not just be focused on shareholders, but we need to extend the definition to other stakeholders. You know, when we do business, you know, our strategy should, you know, make sure we take care and we target our employees, our customers, the environment, and also the society, the communities where we are operating. So, you know, it was a bold statement. Like I said, this was August last year, and everybody was waiting to see, well, what's going to happen? It's been a year. So it's been a year now. Of course, they can use the pandemic as an excuse saying, well, we can really do what we wanted to do. But at the same time, this could actually be an opportunity for them to turn things around and make those, you know, their companies more purposeful and really focus on other parts of the society instead of just on the shareholders. And they got a warning. Again, like I said, there's a lot of looking at what, you know, CEOs and businesses are doing. So right away when they came out last year, a month later, there was an article saying, CEOs, be careful. You know, make sure that whatever you said in August at your meeting is not just purpose washing. Basically walk the talk. So it's been a year to be continued. I think, yes, the pandemic probably delayed a lot of these plans, but should not be an excuse to cancel them. So I'd say I'm really hopeful by the end of this year, early next year, we will be seeing a change if these CEOs were really serious about making changes in businesses. But also it's interesting because what this is showing also is so many companies get criticized because of all the washing that I mentioned, that some companies are actually doing good stuff and they're deciding not to promote it, not to talk about it. So it's what we're calling the secret sustainability because they're afraid. They're afraid that, you know, if they put something out there, they're gonna be scrutinized or they're gonna be criticized. So, you know, sometimes it's on their website, sometimes it's not. A good way of knowing is if you know anybody working in those companies, ask them. what's going on internally, because most of the time the employees will know what's going on. You know, another thing that I'd say is hopeful is, you know, when you do, you know, when your company decides to put in place, create a CSR strategy, you know, there's, like I said, depending if you do services, products, you have to have a different reflection. But then, of course, you need to follow a framework. I love the Sustainable Development Goals of the United Nations. These are 17 goals that they started about 10 years ago. And first it was, you know, focus for governments, but then they decided a few years later, well, no, companies could actually also be embracing these goals to make, you know, the planet a better place. And that's, a recommendation that I give, you know, organizations when they're about to start a strategy in CSR, they don't know where to start. That's what I tell them. I say, go and look at the SDGs that we call them, because there are 17 goals and each goal has different targets. So it's easy for a company to look at the 17 goals and say, well, these two or three are really aligned with our businesses. We're going to be focusing on these goals. And, you know, then you could also pick your targets. So this is a positive sign, because as the years, you know, progress, more and more companies are adapting these goals in their strategies. So, so far 80% of companies do include SDGs in their CSR reports. And you'll see, like, these goals are really, it just makes sense. Like, for example, goal number eight is the most common one that companies will adopt in their CSR reporting. So decent work, economic growth, really easy. So you can see, like, any employee initiative would go into that goal. Gender equality, good health and well-being. So these are really, really make sense for our society and for companies to go and look at these goals and say, well, I'm going to go, like, for example, I'm thinking number four, quality education. So obviously this would be a goal, for example, that any university would adopt and, you know, including the report. If you are more interested in this, I do recommend that you look at KPMG. KPMG puts out a report every year on the SDGs, specifically at the different companies that they work with. And they do, you know, they follow their companies and they follow the progression that the companies are having with their SDGs. And it's really interesting. So this is, for example, part of their report. So you see, like, again, like I was saying, countries that are following and reporting on their SDGs progression. So you see, obviously, Europe is leading the way, US at the bottom, but still part of it is there. The most common SDGs that companies are adopting is, of course, climate change. So climate action, decent work and economic growth, that one makes sense. And then good health and well-being. And then the last three, which, you know, need a little bit of boost and a little bit of love, is zero hunger. But I mean, you could see, like, any company in the food industry could, you know, be tackling this one. Life on land and life below water are the three that are getting the least attention so far. So we've been talking about reports, but how do you make sure that when you have to read a report, if you're searching for a company and you want to know if the company is actually true, authentic, and they have a report, so how do you go about to find out, well, is this a real good report? Like, is whatever they're sharing responsible communication? So I'll give you some examples of the good, the bad, and the ugly. So the good, you need to find authenticity in that report. Like, for example, Starbucks, so their mission is to source sustainable, ethically grown coffee beans. And they actually, they give you an example. They give you the example of, you know, an organization they work with in Congo. So there you go, the story is there. So, you know, it matches what they're saying with what they're doing. Another example, which is really important, is, you know, the company has to, you know, address and show progression. So if you were to read the last 3-4 reports, you should be able to see a progression year after year of, you know, their targets and where they are. So percentages are included. So you are able to follow what's going on. Another good aspect is good transparency. So a CSR report is not just about focusing on the positives. You also need to, you know, discuss the negatives, discuss your risks. So this is an example of Coca-Cola. Not only are they discussing their product innovation, but they're also discussing the plastic waste, which is a problem, a risk, and they're addressing it. So, you know, again, your CSR, good CSR report should be a reflection for a company on, you know, what are the goods that they're doing, but also what are the risks that they're addressing and what they need to be more aware of. The bad is when you are omitting information. And this is an example in the UK. So insurance companies are probably, the insurance industry is probably the industry that is the most affected by climate change for obvious reasons. So these were examples of companies who in their CSR report didn't even mention climate risk. So, you know, they were taken to court because the investors were saying, well, you're not giving us the full picture. You're not telling us the full story because you're not even addressing climate risk as being a risk for our industry. So again, going back to the example from Coca-Cola, you need to address it. You need to mention it, you know, and then just be humble and say, well, we're not doing enough here and we have to put these actions in place to make sure that we are addressing it. And then the ugly is when you lie. So I don't know if anybody remembers the scandal from Volkswagen. This was in 2015 and their emission scandal. So basically they installed this device software in diesel cars. They sold these cars to their environmental friendly customers saying, look, you can buy our cars and you're gonna have, you know, you're gonna pollute less. And it wasn't true because that software in the car was deceiving and was not giving the right information. So this was a huge scandal. So they wanted to look environmental friendly and it backfired. So, you know, as a summary, when you're looking at CSR reports, you need to look at authenticity. Is what I'm reading authentic? Like for example, the Starbucks example, if there's examples, you know, to back up what the company is saying. Discuss progression. Can you see that there's been a progression from last year to this year? Demonstrate transparency, like for example, the Coca-Cola, you know, discuss your risks, but also discuss your positive actions. You know, don't omit relevant information and of course, don't lie. So, you know, this is the story of the report, but then you could just have during the year CSR messages because not every company will have a CSR report. And also, or maybe because some companies would add CSR messages to amplify the information in the CSR report. So when it comes to throughout the year CSR messages, what should you be looking for to make sure that these messages are responsible and are authentic? So I'll give you examples that are specific to the situation of corona washing and the coronavirus that we just went through. But I would say like the three takeaways when you're looking at responsible communications related to CSR messages, again, it should make sense to you when you're seeing these messages that there's an alignment, coherence with the company. There's transparency and humbleness with the messages that are being put out there and authenticity. Once again, the walk, the talk is obvious to you. So I'll give you I would say this was my top five examples of Quebec, of coronavirus, you know, good examples in Quebec. So this was Sam Wilson, for example. So they do suits for men and they turned their operations around to do gowns for people working in the healthcare industry. And I felt that was, you know, a good example because, you know, their purpose, when you go back to the purpose of Sam Wilson, what is it? It's to dress people. So they were able to turn around and just dress people differently in another way, but to continue helping, you know, and following their purpose. I put Bauer and CCM in fourth place because that too was, you know, a bit similar, but a bit more complex. So for example, they do visors for hockey. So you can see that picture there on the right. So they turned that model around to, you know, come and help again, healthcare people. So, you know, the CCM one at the bottom is a little bit more complex. It was for, you know, doctors and surgeons. And the one at the top, I really like Bauer because that was a more easy accessible model. And it was so popular that what they decided to do was they put a PDF on their website. I think it's still there so that people could do their own. So it's do your own visor based on, you know, Bauer's model. You know, and I'm just thinking about the employees working these companies where the companies come up with these stories. One, it's keeping them busy during the pandemic. And then too, like just the pride to be working for these companies that can turn things around to help the society when it's a need that is there. Another example that I really liked was this one that came from the Chateau Frontenac in Quebec. So they turned a ballroom into a big kitchen, and then they just did a lot of meals for the homeless in Quebec City. But what I really like is that quote from the chef of the Chateau Frontenac. He says, "It's our job to feed people. We are kitchen chefs." So again, it's going back to the purpose. What is the purpose of a chef? It's to feed people, regardless if it's a fancy restaurant, if it's, you know, the restaurant at the corner. When there's a need, you turn it around. So I love this quote from him. Another one that I really liked was Desjardins. Desjardins, at one point, I couldn't keep up with all the different statements that were coming out. What I like about what Desjardins did during the pandemic was that they really thought about their different stakeholders or important groups. So, you know, helping local businesses with, you know, the different funds that they put in place, you know, looking out for their customers, like the insurance customers that they have. You know, basically they came up and they said, "You have a car, you're not using it. Here, I'm going to give you your premiums back," which makes perfect sense. Even, you know, the customers with credit cards, they got help. Employees, I know also internally they got help. You know, they were all provided with support to work from home. So that's, you know, to me, a responsible, you know, company. When you are able to go back, so this again, like a service company. So it's looking at what services do I offer and what can I do to make things better for society now that there's a need. And then finally, another, you know, example to me was, wow, was Videotron. So Videotron providing internet service. To me, Videotron was how proactive they were. So if you look at the date that I circled there, pandemic was declared March 12th. So they knew a lot of people were going to go work from home. So the next day they come out and they say, "We're lifting the data caps on all residential and business internet plans for existing customers." So they didn't wait. They right away, they were proactive to help their customers. And then a few weeks later in April, knowing that this pandemic was going to be a little bit longer than what we expected, they came back and they said, "We're extending the plan." So that's what a good company does is, you know, you're proactive. Again, you're looking at the services and you say, you're thinking, "What can I do with my services to help my customers, to help society?" And I don't know if you saw this yesterday, so with the big explosion in Beirut, Lebanon this week, they actually announced yesterday, you know, because they also provide telephone services. Any long distance fees to Lebanon are not going to be charged the next couple of weeks. So people who have to call home in Lebanon, well, no fees. So like I was saying, so actually, like, this is so interesting for me that I actually joined the Credibility Institute in July to do some research more into all of this. So I interviewed 15 senior communication professionals in July to talk about what is responsible communications. You know, when you're, you know, dealing with CSR reports or messages and sustainability, what do you look for? So I asked them, you know, how do you make sure your messages are responsible? How do you make sure your messages, you know, are washing? Like, how do you avoid washing? So basically, they all came up with the top three. It's, you need to show facts. You need to show examples. So you have to be authentic. So show authenticity and also transparency. So those are the three key things to make sure that you will come out as responsible communications and you will be seen as a responsible citizen company out there. So the three key takeaways from my examples and from my interviews is, yeah, you've shown alignment with what you do. Like, for example, Videotron using their services to make things better. Desjardins the same. And the chef at the firm, we feed people. Transparency. So Bauer, CCM, that's another example. Samuelson. And authenticity, so walk the talk. So it's not just about making donations, it's really about making a difference based on what you can offer and, you know, do the best. So it's really like, you know, what can my services and products do to benefit the society? So this is what good CSR is. It's not just about giving donations and making those huge, you know, donations to companies and society. And I'll show you now another example. Chipotle is Mexican. Some people would call it fast food Mexican. We don't have it in Quebec, but elsewhere in Canada, if you've been to Ontario, you know Chipotle. And they really, when they came out saying like, we're really good and we really want to focus on sustainable agriculture. And then they become so popular that they became a victim of the popularity. So this was a video that they did back to the start, and I'll show you this in a few seconds. Was they came up with this really good concept. They wanted to be, you know, more local, focus on local foods, you know, sustainable agriculture, work with their local farmers. And it became so popular that it kind of derailed. It derailed, and you know, but it's, you know, kudos to the founder, because they realized that they had derailed from their purpose and, you know, what they wanted to do with the company. So that's why, like, go back to the start, you know, go back to, you know, again, like that local, more smaller aspect of it, which is a good thing. I think a lot of companies, as they grow, they will lose their sense of purpose, or they will lose their vision. So if you go back to why you started your company and you go back to your purpose, you are able to maintain your CSR sustainability journey. It derails when the profits really take over. But I do believe that any good company, if you focus on why you exist, will be able to show they're good citizens in the corporate world. This is another example we have in Canada. Maple Leaf Food has been seen as a good citizen for many reasons, you know, the way they've handled crisis in the past, but also this statement that they came up last year about wanting to be the world's first major carbon neutral food company. And I'll show you now the video of their CEO explaining what this means for the company.
Our company's vision is to be the most sustainable protein company on Earth. Today, we've taken our biggest and boldest step ever by becoming the first major food company in the world to become carbon neutral. At Maple Leaf Foods, we produce high-quality, nutrient-dense animal and plant protein products. But producing quality products like ours consumes natural resources, and like all businesses, we generate emissions. For years now, We've been working to reduce our emissions with a goal of a 50% reduction by 2025. But the urgency of the climate crisis compelled us to become carbon neutral now. In addition to our ongoing emissions reductions efforts, we've done two additional things. First, we've doubled down on our commitment to reduce our emissions by adopting a new, higher science-based target through 2030. These are globally respected emission reduction targets aligned with the goals of the Paris Agreement on climate change. And they're approved by a third-party science-based target initiative. Committing to these targets mean that we must continue to reduce our emissions even as we grow. Second, we've now committed to invest immediately in high-quality projects throughout Canada and the United States that reduce greenhouse gases and bring our net carbon footprint to zero. These projects support green wind energy, recovery of methane gas for energy from landfills, recycling programs, composting to reduce methane emissions, forest protection, and enhancement of Indigenous land to ensure species protection, biodiversity, and reforestry. We are the first major food company in Canada to adopt science-based targets. And we are one of only two animal protein companies in the world to adopt these targets, which makes us leaders in emissions reduction. But we are the first major food company in the world to achieve carbon neutrality. That's a monumental step forward, and we hope our actions will inspire other companies to see what is not only possible, but urgent. Climate change is a serious global problem, perhaps the greatest problem humanity has ever faced. People expect business leaders to lead on issues like climate change, and we are proud to do just that. Our children and our grandchildren are counting on big, bold actions to ensure their bright future. They deserve nothing less than our full commitment. They certainly have that commitment from Maple Leaf Foods.
So, I would say what I liked about this video is, of course, he lists all the projects, all the initiatives that they're going to do, but he starts off by saying, you know, we produce emissions and we know this is a problem and we need to tackle this problem. So it goes back to what I was saying. It's about, you know, showing, being transparent. You know, he's not only talking about the positives that are coming up, but he has addressed the risks, he has addressed the negatives that the company is responsible for. Here's another good example that I like. So a local example, Aldo. You know, what I like about their CSR, they're very, you know, driven when it comes to their CSR initiatives is they have a lot of, you know, actions towards their employees. You know, they have a lot of actions towards, you know, gender equality, you know, and also engagement in, programs for employees, but then also on the environment for their customers. And for example, here's a, I love it that, you know, if you've been to, the, what they call the Montreal campus in Ville Saint-Laurent, they have these gardens for employees, they have all these, you know, different initiatives. So you must, you might have followed during the pandemic, although it's not doing so well, you know, nowadays, they're actually going to be moving out of their campus in Ville Saint-Laurent. They're going to a smaller, you know, company, a smaller building. So it's to be determined, to be continued, what's going to happen with their CSR report. You know, usually when, you know, companies go through some, you know, difficulties, some of these programs, unfortunately, do get cut. So to be continued, to be seen what's going to happen to Aldo, because so far they've been pretty good leaders in their industry when it comes to CSR. So I'd like to know now, like, what companies do you admire for their CSR sustainability actions? If we could put, you know, I'd like to see some of that in the chat. Mm-hmm. Any companies that come to mind? Patagonia, yeah, MasterCard. RBC, well, so it's interesting. Also part of Danone, yes. Also part of the study that I did in June, I did a survey and I surveyed 100 people across the country. And I also asked this question. And I would say, you know, I had different, you know, companies, like I just saw TD being mentioned. I would say banks are doing a really good job at either getting their, you know, their CSR actions, you know, visible, because they come up a lot. They come up a lot when we ask people, like, what companies do you admire? Either because, you know, you're a customer at those banks and you've seen something that they've done, or you know someone who works there pretty good. Starbucks, yes. Yes, yeah, Starbucks, Patagonia, Ben and Jerry's. Yeah, we'll be talking about those. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, RBC. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I would say, yeah, banks do a really good job at getting their actions noticeable. And, you know, again, like going back, when they go back to, okay, well, we do services, what can our services do to help society? You know, the different groups, you know, the, like you're saying, the students, your customers, your employees, yeah, for sure. Even insurance companies, yeah. And Rishi, you know, I worked in insurance for almost 10 years. And of course, the insurance industry gets a lot of bad rep, but it's because I find they forget again their purpose. Like, company, insurance companies exist, why? They, basically, their purpose is to help, you know, people, to protect people. That's why the insurance industry exists. But then it derails. I keep saying it. It derails when profits become the most important thing. And it's like, I used to have a CEO that drove me insane, like a global CEO that said, we are here to win for shareholders. That's the worst thing you can tell someone who wants to do an impact in society. But again, it's because you forget about, like, why are you there? Excellent. Great. Okay. So there's also companies whose the social impact is part of their DNA. Like, so there's some industries, for example, if you work in healthcare, if you work in education, you don't need to think about CSR and what am I going to do? It's part of your DNA. Like, healthcare is to help society be better. Education, the same. A nonprofit, it's part of their DNA. Social enterprise, part of a DNA. B Corp, Emily, you were mentioning B Corp, so I'll be talking about that. And then there's others. So, you know, that some, if you search, they probably don't have a CSR sustainability report. They might have an impact report. Like, I know a lot of colleges and universities will call their report the impact report. But speaking of B Corp, so yes, this is a, you know, a bunch of companies on their own, and their DNA is to do good. It's really about, like, how am I doing good for my workers, my customers, suppliers, community, and then the environment. And it's a certification process. It's pretty, I wouldn't say complicated, but it's a long, because, you know, company who wants to get into the certification to become a B Corp has to go through a lot of questions, a long questionnaire, and really decide, okay, I'm really focused and I'm really serious and I really want to be part of this movement. So as of today, 3,469 companies in the world have the B Corp certification, and it's across 74 countries, 150 different industries. And again, you know, their purpose is really to make sure, you know, there's a balance between purpose and profit, and it's, you know, taking care of their workers, customers, suppliers, community, and then the environment. These are some examples. So you can go on the B Corp website if you are interested and curious to see what companies have this, you know, certification. And it's very interesting. So we were talking, Emily, you mentioned, some other people mentioned Patagonia. So Patagonia is a B Corp. And I like what, you know, their CEO says. It serves more than just the shareholders, really. It's the equal responsibility to the community and then to the planet. When you have made that commitment to become a certified B Corporation, so B for benefit. I think I'll show you this video, because I find this video really explains well what B Corp is and why it matters.
Corporate law in the U.S. really mandates directors to have the duty to just maximize profit by any means. Shifting the role of business to be more about just maximizing shareholder value. And so whether you do have a very strong mission statement, really you need to make decisions based on the best interest of your investors. There's no way for us as a customer to really see the difference between a good company and just good marketing. And so we created a company level certification called B Corp, returning back to where it began, of allowing a director to consider more than just profit.
Capitalism and the way that businesses run right now are a human construct. It's that way because we decided it would be that way. Just being a B Corp, just involving yourself in this space and in this community, you're changing the direction of the way businesses operate.
There is a lot of negative feelings about capitalism right now. Capitalism, it's kind of this really powerful engine for innovation, for organizing people. The question is, how do we protect ourselves from capitalism while deriving the benefits of it?
In order to achieve B Corp certification, a company has to meet a variety of goals and benchmarks in areas including how they treat their workers, how they control their environmental impact, and how they work with underserved communities. Really, any sort of for-profit business structure, LLC, corporation, are able to achieve B Corp certification. It's a really great way to formalize and bake those principles into the foundational legal documents of that company.
Patagonia, since its beginning in 1973, has been committed to environmental protection. We helped the founders of the B Corp movement develop their certification tool. For a new company, it can be a guide for how to set up a company, not just to deliver value to the shareholders, but for benefit to society and environmental protection.
It's almost like a checklist, you know, for us and say, well, how serious are you about being a socially responsible company? From a business perspective, we cannot prosper unless the whole society prospers.
We knew this was going to be a challenging endeavor, you know, to try and rally all these companies together to get people to do assessments, to gradually start changing the laws of the land. And one of the things that we've been really passionate about is demonstrating that that is not only possible, but it's incredibly lucrative and it's incredibly fun.
You know, as a small business, you come up against a lot of challenges. Doing things the right way might cost a little more. Knowing that you have this structure of B Corp behind you to keep you on the right path, we're able to answer questions before we even knew to ask them. Berea was founded by ocean-minded people. We're all surfers. Everywhere we were traveling, we were seeing plastic pollution. We came up with the idea that we were going to collect plastic, recycle it, and make a product out of it.
We're very grounded in a way because we make things. We make soap. That's a very humble daily item that we all use. But whatever you do, I think you can make it in a way where all the relationships are just and fair.
Yerba mate natively grows in the rainforest, but commercially people have pulled it out of the forest. So our whole vision was about bringing it back to the forest where it natively grows, be able to partner with forest communities, and then have this amazing product. It's really this virtuous cycle. It's like the more that we can share mate and get it out there, the more we can build and restore and renew.
If governments won't do it, businesses can organize and become B Corp and raise awareness in a way that governments can't.
Success here would be everybody being a B Corp because every consumer of a product or service on planet Earth knows what a B Corp is and want to only support B Corp companies. Wouldn't that then incentivize the boards of directors of big multinational companies to become B Corps? That's what we want the world to look like.
Now we're looking at close to 2,000 certified B Corps operating across 50 countries, representing over 130 different industries. We now have over 100 different versions of our assessment based on where the company is, how big it is, and what industry it's in. What we hope is that then that redefines success, and so that all companies compete not just to be the best in the world, but the best for the world.
Correct. So you see now more in detail what B Corp is and why it matters. And so, like I was saying, if you go on the website, you can actually see the different reports and the different scores that every company that became certified gets. And like I said, any company that decides to become certified, it is a commitment, because every 3 years you need to recertify. And the tricky thing is you need to improve the score from the last time you recertified. So here's the example of Ben and Jerry. So 110, and it's usually out of, it's 200. So you need to get a score of 80, at least 80, to be able to get, your certification. So 110, this was, the last number that we have for Ben and Jerry's. And it's really interesting. If you go on the website, you could actually see in details. So, the assessment looks at governance of the company, the workers, what are you putting in place for your employees? What are you doing for your community? What are you doing for the environment? And then, so you see also the different scores. So for example, when Ben and Jerry's became certified, they got 86%, and they were able to increase that score to 110 the next time they became recertified. Because if you don't improve your score, you will lose your certification. And then it really goes into detail. So for example, the workers, they look at the questionnaire will look at compensation, wages, benefits, training, education, ownerships. Some companies will give that opportunity for employees. Community, are you a job creator? Do you have diversity, inclusion, civic engagement, all that stuff. So it's really interesting, because on the website, you could really see where the companies are doing good. And normally, companies will do much better in one aspect than the other, which is fine. But then it's also helping the companies, kind of target where they have to work to make it better next time. I like Danon. Someone mentioned Danon in the chat. I'd say 2 years ago, Danon Canada became B Corp certified. So the strategy of Danon, because it's a huge global company, is they have become B Corp certified in different countries. And eventually they have a really bold goal to become, the whole company become B Corp certified by 2030. So this was their score. So you see, they just got 83. So like I said, the minimum is 80 points. But this is really good, because it just shows that they have a lot of room for improvement for next time that they recertify. And this is good. You can see there the areas of impact. So obviously you see community could actually be a place where they could focus their attention to improve their scores, for example. So that's why, it's really interesting to go on the website. And like I was saying, so they're aiming to become the whole Danon Group is aiming to become a B Corp by 2030. And then our own products, if you know the products, this is a material-based company. Latest score is 123. And it's interesting, because they became a B Corp in 2015 with 81%. And then you can see there that they're pretty strong when it comes to the environment. Community and workers are also doing well. And this, for smaller companies like Prana, it's also an advantage when they go and knock on doors, if they want to become suppliers of any major company. The B Corp certification is also a competitive advantage for smaller companies. So now if we shift specifically now at engaging employees with your CSR programs, and I'll show you some stats, and I use this stat from 2012, which is already a little bit outdated, almost 10 years ago, but it's really to show, this is really when we started to see a shift in the mindset of employees, of students finishing and going into the workplace, and workers getting into the workplace. and looking for work. So just before net impact, what is net impact? This is a global movement, and it's students and young leaders. And again, like they want to change the way purposes, the purpose of businesses are. They want to make sure that, you know, there's a good for society and the environment when leaders are working for companies. And we do actually, so like I said, it's a global movement. There's, you know, many, over 400 chapters around the world. You will find most of these chapters, it's interesting, in business schools. So another, you know, big force pushing for change when it comes to business is business students. Nowadays, you know, business students are asking for more responsible investment, responsible finance courses, for more sustainability courses in the MBA and all the different management programs, which I love. And McGill does have a net impact chapter. So and of course, it's part of the Deshotel School of Management. So you can actually Google it and you can see who's, you know, in charge and who's running the net impact chapter at McGill. But what's interesting is when you look at, the question was, what is very important or essential for my happiness? And number three, a job where I can make an impact. So, and why I say it's interesting is because, so 10 years ago, these were the millennials getting into the workplace. And now we have the Gen Z coming into the workplace, and they're even more eager to have a social impact where they work. So, you know, these people are now in the workplace. So, you know, that's what you're seeing, I think, you know, companies taking notice and, you know, putting in place more and more sustainability and CSR initiatives, because they know that to be able to retain those employees, they need to make an impact. They need to focus on other things than profits. This was other results, you know, company, you know, when they did the survey, they asked, would you take a pay cut? And yes, I would take 15% pay cut to work for a company committed to CSR, to work for a job that makes a social or environmental impact, to work for an organization with values like mine. So these numbers said a lot. And like I said, this was almost 10 years ago, and this trend has just been continuing to grow. Deloitte also does a really interesting survey every year. They focus specifically on volunteer at work. So again, volunteering at work has also become really important. Not just for volunteering at work in general, but companies realize that the employees do value volunteer work. So, you know, this survey from Deloitte just shows that if companies can provide volunteer opportunities for their employees, either in the workplace or by, you know, rewarding their employees to do volunteer work, they will have a more engaged workforce. And I kept this testimonial that I got from an employee when I worked in an insurance company a couple of years ago. So I was running, it was a national regional charity program. So we had, you know, a charity committee in every office, and they were doing fundraising activities. And we had someone in charge in every office. So Melissa, who was an analyst, so she spent her day working with spreadsheets. And she was really good. She was out of Sherbrooke. And I just sent her a little recognition saying, thank you so much. Like, in every event that you do is well organized and everything is well received. And she sent me that note, and I loved it because it said, thanks, Paula. These activities help to bring a great balance between the spreadsheets that fill my days at work. So it just shows, you know, your employees and the employees in general, if they can have something else to work on and focus on at work, besides their day-to-day daily duties, it really helps to get them motivated, to get them to continue. I'll now show you some other examples that I really like of companies who engage their employees in different activities for their CSR initiatives. So we talked a lot about banks. So these are a couple of examples that I have here of banks. CIBC, they do the shoreline cleanup activity with the WWF. So they go into different beaches and different areas where there's water to clean. And what I like about CIBC is that they invite their employees and their families. So if families join their employees, it's a, you know, big get together one day a year. tell us does something similar. They actually do what they call their days of giving. So it's a list of, you know, charities, different activities that the employees can sign up for. What I like about TELUS is that they also engage their retirees, which I love, because your retirees are a big group of ambassadors, you know, employees that worked for you and they're now retired, but they can still come back and give back and also inspire your current employees. So I really like this initiative from TELUS. And then of course, we talked about, you know, TD Bank, well known for, you know, their tree planting activities and their commitment to the environment. And then I also like that not only they engage their employees and their families and friends, but also members of the community. So anybody interested, you know, if there's a tree planting activity, anybody in that neighborhood can participate with the employees from TD, which is great because then there's possible interactions between employees and customers, and it's good. So let me go now. Like I said, I did a survey earlier this year, actually last month in July, where I surveyed employees and I wanted to know more about, like, is this really true? Like, are employees really engaged when it comes to CSR programs in their workplace? So my question was, does your organization have employee engagement programs related to its corporate social responsibility? So let me see, I'm gonna launch the poll. And I wanna see which programs does your organization offer, if any of these. So the options are matching donations, donations for volunteer time, individual volunteer time, team volunteer time, two of the above, all of the above. No, also. Okay. I'll give it 5 more seconds. Okay, so share results. So, and also my survey showed this. Matching donations is very popular. So that's when you make a donation to a nonprofit organization and then you show the proof and your organization will match that same donation. Donations for volunteer time. So if you volunteer, I don't know, 50, 100 hours, you bring in a letter from that organization, then your employer will give a donation of $100, $500 for that organization. Or, yeah, no. And then my survey also showed, of course, a lot of individual volunteer time. So like I was showing, like CIBC or, you know, TELUS, when you have activities, volunteer activities that are organized by the employer, or team volunteer time. You know, this is like those examples. Individual would be more like you can take a day off or 2 days off during the year to volunteer with the organization of your choice. That would be the option. I also got a lot of no in my survey, and it was from a lot of people who work for smaller companies or startups or smaller companies that don't have these kind of corporate big programs in place. But I did have a lot of people who actually mentioned different sustainability initiatives. You know, like you have some recycling program in the kitchen, that kind of thing too. So that also counts, especially if you're a smaller company. Sometimes like, yeah, obviously like this would not be sustainable for a smaller company or a startup, but you can have some other different initiatives that you have in place in the company. So let's now, let me go back. So CSR Beyond, so like the examples that I've gave you so far are, you know, the standard volunteer programs and donations. So, you know, an organized nonprofit organization has an activity and you take part of it. So the next step for an organization who wants to put in place programs to engage your employees would be aligned with their purpose. So link it or create then a volunteer program. And I'll give you a few examples. So for example, Air Canada, their program of Dreams Take Flight. When you think back again, the reflection of purpose, what is the purpose of an airline company? Is to bring someone from point A to point B. So what they do with this program is they bring in children that are medically or mentally or emotionally challenged, and they have a dream. So they bring them on these flights. And it's volunteer based. What this means is like the pilots, the flight attendants, or the ground crew, they're not being, you know, they're volunteering their time to do this during their working time. So this is a way of showing like, you know, your purpose. You are bringing now people on your purpose journey to do good. Another example that I like is, we were talking about that, Aviva. Aviva is an insurance company. So again, when you think back, what is the purpose of insurance is to protect people. So Aviva did a partnership with the Canadian Red Cross to send their employees as volunteers when there's catastrophes in the country. For example, when there's floods, when there's, you know, wildfires. And, you know, of course, those communities will need help. They will need, you know, people to help. So the Aviva puts in place a group of volunteer employees to go. And I'll share a testimonial from an employee. So it has that impact. So you'll see how important it is.
In May 2016, the Canadian Red Cross responded to its largest natural disaster response in its history, the Alberta wildfires. Because of partners like Aviva, the Canadian Red Cross can be there in the immediate aftermath of these disasters, but also in the months and the years to come to support those that have been affected.
A Ready When the Time Comes volunteers came together from 8 cities across Canada. Within 24 hours, they were on the ground and gave over 500 hours of their time to help the rehabilitation effort.
It just means being there for people, helping them, being involved in your community, assisting in any kind of disaster, small or big, and just lending a helping hand.
I took a call from an elderly gentleman, 62 years old. His name is Wilfred. And he really touched my heart because he was all alone. He was calling me from a shelter. He lived in a rural area in Alberta and didn't have any access to the internet, a computer. He called me and we talked. I got home that evening. I turned on the news and I felt very touched that I was able to, in some way, contribute as well.
You know, I've been in the insurance industry my entire life, and to work for a company, to know that we don't just support people in collecting a premium and paying a claim, that we partner with the Red Cross, and that we're there as volunteers, as just people. You don't realize when a disaster happens how much you depend on the average everyday person to give you some guidance to help you when you're so lost.
I've never had to deal with firsthand losing everything like some of these people have, but having been a part of the relief efforts, it's something that now I know. I've talked to these people and I know through them what they've gone through, and absolutely 100% I would do it again. I would help out any way I could.
I cannot emphasize the importance of corporate responsibility. The volunteers getting involved, because without volunteers, Red Cross doesn't exist.
I want to thank Aviva for being there in the beginning of this event, but also for their ongoing support in preparing to help those that are most vulnerable in these kinds of situations in Canada. So again, thank you.
Let me show you now another example, Amia. AMIA does this really cool thing called the Global Week of Philanthropy. So AMIA is, they used to manage the Aeroplan loyalty program from Air Canada. And their major workforce are analysts. So analysts that would analyze the different data from the loyalty Aeroplan customers. So they put in place this this week, and it's to help nonprofits that get all this different information from customers, but they don't know what to do with the data. So I'll show you what this week is for.
Thank you. think an event like this is really important because it gives us an opportunity to do something outside of our day-to-day, develop new skills or improve existing skills, and do something that really matters in our community.
And as you can see, I mean, everybody's so engaged. The questions coming out are amazing. They're really getting us to think about some of the data we use in some really cool ways.
Working with not-for-profits or charitable organizations that will really benefit from having some data analytics.
We've worked with more than 50 charities over the last 4 years, and it really is humbling to hear from them what impact that we've had.
It's been amazing. It's an amazing journey, and we've given them so much back.
And I'll show you one last example. PwC, so Prince Waterhouse, their access to potential, so their financial literacy program.
5 years ago, we set out on a journey. Today, our journey continues to help students develop critical financial skills and includes equipping students with tech skills for the jobs of today and tomorrow. This is our opportunity to close the education, skills, and opportunity gap in our communities by empowering educators and inspiring students to help today's youth become tomorrow's tech-driven workforce and business leaders to access their potential.
These examples
5 years ago.
You know, companies who look at their purpose and they look at, their skills, and they realize, they decide and they design different initiatives on how my skills, how my purpose can help beyond my business objective, right? So this would be, I would say, the second level. If you are, developing programs to engage your employees, is, look at your purpose, look at, your skills, and how can you make those skills, available for society to make a difference. And then I would say the other part, the top, would be like creating opportunities of engagement in a specific aspect of your CSR strategy. For example, if you have diversity and inclusion as part of your strategy, how do you get your employees involved in that? Emission reductions, how do you get your employees involved? Safety, for example, in plants, it's really important. It's a regulation. So how do you make employees involved in that? And I have a few other examples. I love this example from McGill. McGill has this commitment when it comes to sustainability, reducing the emissions. So they've put in place these gardens on campus for staff to be engaged. And they won an award for it. And I love this story. So I don't know if anybody in CATS was involved or is involved in any of these programs, but I love this. They also have a level of certification for the different events going on campus. So your event could be certified bronze, when it comes to sustainable. And I know, like, I always like to invite someone from the Office of Sustainability to come talk in my class. It also created this network of ambassadors at McGill, among staff, and also a little bit of, competition. Like, for example, someone was telling me that in the Faculty of Engineer, one day they got the bronze certification for their events, and then like they challenged another group to get the silver and then the gold. So it just creates a lot of, good dynamics in the workplace when you have these kind of, programs that will engage your employees. And then, if it helps your sustainability strategy, well, even better. Here's another example. This is from RBC, and they're very committed to their diversity and inclusion strategy. So they've put in place a lot of employee resource groups. This is growing. A lot of companies are putting in place these employee resource groups. So for example, they have a group specific for women, Pride, LGBT, employees with disabilities or, you know, indigenous or visible minorities. So it's really like groups of employees that will get together that have some affinities, and then to help them grow within that business to make sure that, you know, their whatever challenges that they have are being heard. And so, you know, it's the opportunity that the employer puts there that really helps the employees become more engaged and help the company eventually with their strategy. So here's another question for you. I'm going to launch the poll. So here it is. Think back when you applied to your current position. Did you search the organization's corporate social responsibility strategy? Yes or no? Okay, interesting. Yes. Oh my God, it's interesting. It's absolutely exactly the results I got from my survey in July. Yes. So 63%, about 2/3 said yes, and 1/3 said no. What's interesting in my survey was that I could link it to those who've been working in their organizations for more than 9 years, so longer. They said, well, this was not part of my mindset then when I was looking for a job. I didn't think about those things. But those who have been working, you know, for less in an organization, really the CSR strategy is really important. So that's, you know, very interesting. And I believe this trend will just continue growing. You know, more people, when they apply or as they're applying or they're going through the process of hiring, they will be looking for these kind of information on the company. Okay, very good. Okay. And I think and then another one. Yeah, so let me launch this one. How important is it for you to work for an organization with a corporate social responsibility strategy? Very important, somewhat, neutral, not important, really not. Yeah. Okay, so you see it. I think we're in this era now where it is important. You know, your future applicants will be looking for this when they are choosing to change companies or to, you know, picking a company to work for. This will be important in their, part of their, when they're looking for a new job, for sure. Okay, good, okay. So the three key learning points when it comes to engaging employees with your CSR strategies is, you know, so why should you, you know, take that into account? Because it increases motivation. And we saw that with the different testimonials from the videos. It creates ambassadors, champions internally and externally. So, you know, I know at McGill, like it has created this network of ambassadors, but then externally means, you know, they'll be sharing this. They'll be sharing this with their, you know, their neighbors, their friends, their family on their social media. And, you know, if someone sees an employee sharing information about their organization, it just makes that organization more credible. It also gives employees an opportunity to develop skills like either coordination, leadership, or, you know, become more educated on some, you know, specific issue related to the strategy. Then the number two is, you know, good examples of corporate social responsibility programs that include employee engagement. You know, when you let the employees choose the causes they want to support, you will get more engagement. You know, make it easy for them to give back and to get involved. Like, for example, volunteer times. If they can volunteer on their own time. You have to be careful. And I got that feedback from my survey was, yes, it's fine. My company is giving me volunteer time, but I have small children. So if you're putting volunteer days or opportunities outside of work hours, you know, are you alienating a group of your employees and they're not actually going to be happy about that? You also need the leader's buy-in. You know, if the executives are into it, you know, they will push the journey, the CSR journey. For example, why not make your CSR actions like your volunteer into team building activities instead of, you know, paying those really expensive activities of, you know, team building. and partner with nonprofits for excitement and credibility. And we saw that partnership, Aviva and the Red Cross, it's a win-win for both organizations. So think about that. And then finally, you know, measure to determine if, you know, these programs are working. And how can you measure? Well, for example, look at your participation rate. Look at repeated, like if there's an increase from year to year, that's a good sign. If there is repeated, like they keep coming back, that's a really good sign. Look at the post-event comments and testimonials. So here's my final question for you. Oops. So let me just find it. Here you go. So my final question, as an employee, are you motivated to engage in your organization's corporate social responsibility strategy? Yes. Yes. So it's an obvious one, of course. And again, I keep saying, this is really a trend that we're seeing. It's not gonna go away. People do wanna be involved. People do wanna have an impact where they work. Okay. Okay. So as a summary, when it comes to creating your CSR engagement, employees in your opportunities, like I said, you know, when you're starting at first, implement a standard volunteer program. So look at any opportunity with a nonprofit. You know, this following step would be, you know, have a reflection on what your purpose is and link your you know, volunteer program based on your purpose. And the examples were like, for example, EMEA and their data analysts or Air Canada. And then the other step is really link or create an engagement opportunity in a specific aspect of your CSR strategy. Like, for example, McGill Sustainability Office, really important when it comes to reducing their emissions. So they put in place these gardens for staff to participate in. So that's an example. And then finally, I'm gonna leave you with a list of resources. So if you are interested to learn more, to know more, to keep up with trends, these are five that I really like. So Corporate Knights is a newsletter and it's free, you can sign up. It's out of Toronto. So they call themselves the voice of clean capitalism. So they're very skeptical whenever an organization puts something out there. So they will really, you know, dig in and ask questions. So it's really interesting newsletter to follow. Sustainable Brands is also pretty good. It's American based, but you know, they cover a lot of the big brands and their sustainability actions. Benevity Webinars is a mix of Canadian and American. They are very much focused on employee engagement. So they measure exactly like the employee engagement activities and in the workforce. There's Green Biz newsletter. They also offer free webinars. And then the Ethical Corporation news and webinars out of the, you know, the UK, a little bit more, I would say, advanced, but also very good. And also, you know, focusing a lot on the global brands. Good. Okay. So I am anxious. I'm going to stop sharing. And I'm anxious to get questions or comments from anybody.
Well, I just want to say, I want to thank you so much. This has been such a captivating presentation. Oh my gosh, I just learned so much, just the washing, different types of washing. Thank you so much. And I love learning about companies that are doing good and just the ones that are not and what that looks like and how you can, and the resources you shared of how you can figure that out. If anybody has a question, just please speak up or write in the chat. I had a question about, you know, for those that this is only going to rise, this need for companies that are going to be needing to do good, whether they want to do it for their own profits or because, I mean, for an image or because they actually want to do good. And as a career advisor, I speak with so many students who are constantly talking about the importance of just doing work that is meaningful to them, which means doing something that is helpful to society. So what you're saying is aligns totally with my conversations with students all the time. what do you say, and when we look at positions of corporate social corporate responsibility, we see there's such a variety of experiences that are needed. It's hard to tell what it, sometimes there's certification, sometimes not. There's environmental science, business communications, mm-hmm. engineering, sometimes even MBA that's required. It seems to be so vast. How do you, what are your thoughts on how do you get into it if maybe you don't know, if you don't have that specific certification?
Yeah, well, that's a really good question. Yeah, and especially in Canada. And I think overall, there's not a one way, one route into CSR and sustainability, because it will really depend on what the company focuses on. If the company is more focused on environmental issues, they will most likely, like, for example, the McGill Sustainability Office, because they're so focused on their environmental actions, they will likely, I know the people who work there, most of them have environmental studies background. So it will depend. You know, the students coming out of this hotel or any other school management will probably focusing more on, you know, finance, sustainable finance and responsible finance, responsible investing. Like, you know, when I was saying investors are looking at the ESG reports, environmental social governance, these are people coming out of business schools with that sustainability and CSR lens. And that's what they will be doing is, you know, they will be working on these reports that are focused on sustainability. So it really depends on what you have to pick what you want to work on. Like the way I'm seeing it is really like you either have like that environmental more focus, the more investment finance focus, or the more employee focus would be more, you put in place these, you know, charity programs and these partnerships. So it really depends on, you know, where you're going and what your focus is.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
Some questions. Sorry, Teresa. There was a question she had asked much earlier, and I forgot about this one. B Corps, if your score is over 80, and then it has declined over the years, are there any penalties?
You will need to recertify. Well, you'll need to retake the questionnaire, the exam. And it's interesting because B Corps, I think, you know, like when I was talking about the business roundtable, the CEOs last year, I mean, they didn't come out and said, we want to become B Corps, but obviously their, you know, reflection was coming out of, you know, the B Corp movement. I mean, they're not going to go as far as say we want to become B Corps, but it's pretty similar, you know, that to them, the new definition of purpose of a company, of a business is very similar to what B Corps are aiming towards. Yeah.
Makes sense. Vince has a question. What does carbon neutral mean? Can you measure it?
Yes, that's an excellent question. And that's an excellent also, I would say to me, if I had to grade that video that we saw, I would probably give it a B minus or a C, because using words that people don't understand, the general like this, you know, he should have explained carbon neutral in a different way. Like I remember also, we used to have in our strategy when I worked at the you know, the insurance company, reducing your footprint. And then I would have employees say, well, what does that mean? Right? So exactly, you know, like, and that's why sometimes like you're getting this rep and it could be seen as washing is when you're using these expressions that don't really mean a lot to everybody. So carbon neutral is, you know, it's almost like, yeah, also reducing your footprint, making sure that you're not increasing pollution with your operations. And how can you measure it? Vince, that's a really good idea. So I would not be able to measure it because I don't have the background information and, you know, the training to do it. This would probably need to be some engineer or someone with environmental studies background expertise. Yeah. So if, you know, for example, I wouldn't be surprised if you went on, you know, Maple Leaf Food, you know, its website, they probably would be hiring someone to measure their, you know, carbon neutral journey. And they would probably be asking these things, someone with environmental studies background or engineering. Yeah. So this would be like very specific. If you work for Maple Leaf for this specific project, it would be very specific environmental. Yeah.
Actually, that reminds me of a friend in France, and he has his master's in something like environmental engineering, and he specifically works on these projects to measure carbon neutrality and all of that.
It reminds me too, like where you would see a lot of people working in that is at the airports. A lot of the airports, if you looked at their sustainability reports, it's all about measuring like the air emissions, you know, water, waste, electricity consumption, all of that. It would be a lot of people with the engineering, electrical engineering.
So true.
Well,
any other questions? I'm wondering if I missed any questions along the way. If you want to, actually, we had a comment from Paul. Okay, wait, I'm gonna read it. Okay, actually, Paul, in the 70s, Paul's still here? Yeah, he's right there, okay. I was the second employee hired by BMO in a special project to favor support for young 18 to 23 year olds 1 year away from their graduation in a unique program of 6 months in which participants earned the basic minimum wage, about $13 an hour, and were guaranteed a job within the bank after completing the program, which focused on improving academic skills, interpersonal relations, and three-week stages in the bank or elsewhere. It was a resounding success while it existed for almost 50 years. Oh my gosh. An example of a corporate contributor to social responsibility in non-manufacturing industry. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, like I said, I think banks have done a really good job at, you know, realizing, you know, their responsibility as corporate citizens. And they just keep reinventing, you know, just adding more and more projects.
Absolutely. Does anyone else, any other questions?
So, you know, I think what I wanted to show was really because, Emily, I know a lot of, you know, students or people reach out and they say, I want to, you know, be in this, you know, do some social, social impact job. I want to have a career with purpose. So really what I wanted to show is like, there's so also many different avenues when you are looking for a job and, you know, don't give up on the corporate sector because like, as you saw, there's a lot of reflection going on to be good. There's a lot of pressure coming from employees, from customers, from investors. So I think we're on a really interesting journey to see changes.
Paula, I find that so encouraging. My question to you is, I know you had mentioned it was mandated to you at some point in your career to start working on a corporate social responsibility while you were working in communications, but what made you kind of continue in that?
Because I just saw the potential. And also, like I showed you, I shared that testimonial I got from that employee. Like I saw how happy employees were to be part of these initiatives. We would see it, like, you know, the motivation whenever we would put out, you know, articles, whenever we'd be put out asking for participants, they were there, you know. And, you know, let's go back, like insurance industry, like she was saying, it's not the most fun, exciting aspect, but to have that other aspect part of your work to make you kind of forget and, you know, be yourself was, you know, very interesting. Plus I did see like, already back then, like 5 years ago, I did see like there was a reflection and things were changing. And, you know, the CEOs are feeling that pressure of, you know, doing good, doing better, and, you know, changing their way of thinking.
That's amazing. I know you had mentioned before that if you want to specialize, maybe it's about getting into or, you know, transitioning into CSR, maybe specializing in either environment, finance, or something employee related. In your case, you were in communications.
Yes. Yeah. So communications very linked to corporate social responsibility and the employee engagement aspect. Like in my case, CSR was under communications and communication was under human resources. So that link with employees had to be there. Like I remember I negotiated a partnership with WWF Canada and the VP of human resources, I was reporting to him. And he basically like every week would say, as I was negotiating, you need to have an employee engagement aspect. You need to have an employee engagement aspect. So that was, you know, to me, like I had to do it. So yeah, so usually when there's employee engagement activities, it will be linked to either human resources or communications.
Communication, that's great. I'm taking so many notes here.
Yeah.
This is fantastic. Thank you so much. I'm gonna ask everyone else if you have any questions, feel free now. I think everyone is blown away by this presentation. Paula, I just want to thank you so much. This was really such a thought-provoking and inspiring session to really make us think about what CSR looks like, why it matters. I think everybody here knows why it matters, and giving us hope into there's more of this coming and how we can actually transition into potentially a career in this or learn more how we can get involved one way or another. If it's not a career, how do you purchase in companies that are doing good and how to learn about that?
Yeah.
So I want to thank you so much. Thank you for your time. Amazing presentation. And I really hope that we can learn, we can stay connected, we can have more sessions by you in the future.
So, well, thank you so much. I think we have my question. Oh, wait. I'm just seeing a question in the chat.
To Emily's question, Paul, my observation seeing her in operation for more than an hour, I think she personifies what she's employed to do. Absolutely.
Well, thank you so much for having me, and thank you all for being here on this Friday afternoon. So I hope I inspired you. Look at those references, if you want to know more and keep up with the trends. Reach out to me if you have any questions eventually or comments.
Fantastic. So people can follow you on Twitter. We have LinkedIn. I put that in the chat now. Am I missing out on anything?
Yeah. No, those are the best. I usually share whatever I share in one, I share on the other. Yeah.
And I'm sharing again the link to replay this session on YouTube. So
fantastic. Thank you so much, Deanna. Okay. Great.